And now, back to brainstorming with Billy.
The living brain.
Now, here's your host, Billy the Brain.
Welcome back. This is Bill Frank, and you're listening to Brainstorming with Billy the Brain here on KKZZ, Positive Talk Radio for Ventura and Santa Barbara Counties. Every show has a theme, and today's theme is excellence in a chosen field. Each of my guests is explaining how to be excellent in a particular field. My next guest has served our country honorably in Operation Enduring Freedom and Iraqi Freedom. He is the former Army Sergeant and author of the book, The Ultimate Basic Training Guidebook, Tips, Tricks, and Tactics for Surviving Boot Camp. He'll tell us about the changes in military training post 9/11 that address terrorism and combating terrorists. And if you have any questions or if you want to join in the conversation, you can call us at 639-0008. Sergeant Michael Volkin is a U.S. Army veteran. He served, as I said, in Operation Enduring Freedom and Iraqi Freedom as a chemical operations specialist, and he received the Army Commendation Medal for his efforts and for the fitness programs that he helped to design for his fellow soldiers. Mike has a bachelor's degree and a master's degree in science from Stephen F. Austin State University in Texas, and he's also a real estate broker. Welcome to the show, Mike. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I am terrific. And thank you so much for being our guest. And on behalf of all of my listeners, I want to thank you, too, for your service to the United States. We greatly appreciate that.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you very much.
Well, what I noticed in doing the background research, though, Mike, is that you have a very interesting story. What makes your story unique is that you really had no intention of serving in the military. There's no history of military service in your family to draw on. So what drew you to join the Army?
Well, actually, 9/11. You know, my father called me in the morning and woke me up. Actually, I was sleeping, and he said, "Hey, turn on the TV." And I thought he was trying to get me to go to some action movie or something. I thought it was a movie preview.
Mm.
And, you know, that point kind of changed my life, where I realized I was kind of taking freedom for granted. I didn't realize how lucky I was being born in this country. And 3 days later, I was sitting in front of the recruiter's office, and he was telling me how great it was, of course, to join the military.
Of course.
And I was facing drill sergeants less than a month later.
Wow. So you were spurred by that action, and it really kindled the patriotism in you. I mean, you said you didn't want to take the freedom that we have for granted, but at that particular moment, what exactly were you feeling as you saw the Twin Towers go down?
Oh, boy. If I could list all the emotions, we'd be here for about 20 minutes, but there was a little bit of everything, but mostly I was feeling that I needed to give back something to my country, and so I told my boss the next day that I wanted to be a part of this upcoming war, and he, you know, fully agreed. So I just kind of dropped everything and left.
And the next thing you know, you are in the Army. Did you have any idea of what you're getting yourself into?
I didn't have the slightest clue, and that's the reason why I wrote the book, is because I didn't want anybody else to go through unprepared like I did. And you know, the book came about as a result of hundreds of soldiers, you know, tips and advice on how to make basic training an easier experience, and that's really, the book is a conglomerate of just dozens and dozens of soldiers' tips and tricks.
And as you were going through basic training, how did you start to compile this book?
You know, I didn't actually expect it to be a book at first. I just started jotting down some tips on how to avoid getting yelled at by drill sergeants. I was actually working security early in the morning. It was about 2 a.m. I was sitting in my Humvee on the side of a quiet road in southern Iraq called Talil. And I was just using a broken pencil and a napkin and what was called an MRE, a meal ready to eat, which I'm sure you've heard of before.
Mm-hmm.
And after my shift, I just transcribed the notes on the napkin to an actual piece of paper. And soldiers started giving me their advice on what they did to make basic training an easier experience. And basically, when I redeployed back to the U.S., it got picked up by a publisher. You know, I sent a couple letters out. And that was 6 years ago. So, you know, it's even gotten some awards here and there, and still selling very strong.
Well, it is obviously a subject matter that appeals to a lot of people, particularly those going into the military. So as you got the information from all of your other fellow soldiers and you started to compile it in a book, you obviously started to see some patterns emerge. So how has basic training changed over the decades, would you say, Mike?
Well, it's changed a lot, and it also hasn't changed at all, to kind of answer your question. For decades, the same basic training regimen has been used, largely derived from experiences gained during World War II and Vietnam, but today we're facing a different kind of enemy, you know, the type of enemy that doesn't wear a uniform, the type of enemy that hides amongst civilian populations. So the higher-ups in the military are fine-tuning their regimen to reflect what a soldier would face on the battlefield today. So, for example, a recruit would learn how to identify IEDs, you know, improvised explosive devices, remote control bombs, how to identify suicide bombers, convoy tactics, urban combat fighting. You know, these upcoming changes, of course, have brought up quite a debate because, you know, should the U.S. military, who has the most disciplined and well-trained soldiers in the world, change so dramatically because of the wars? And they have reflected much more so in the last couple of years. Even the fitness regimen is changing from the old push-ups and sit-ups. Now they're going more towards an obstacle course type of fitness regimen. So there are a lot of little changes, but the core concepts are still the same. You know, you're going to go to basic training. You're going to get yelled at by drill sergeants. You're going to be tired physically and mentally, and those will always be the same.
All right. So the basics of wearing you down emotionally, physically, and mentally still is the crux of it. So it makes it sound like, Mike, that we've added on to basic training, whereas basic training might have been a couple of weeks in the past. It's now maybe extended because of the need to identify IEDs, to pick out terrorists from a crowd and that kind of stuff, added to the overall length of basic training. Has it gotten longer?
It's gotten 1 week longer, specifically referring to the Army. It's now 10 weeks long, and that's the actual basic training. There's a deployment where you have to do paperwork and other, you know, to get shots, a little medical record. That takes a few more days on top of that. So overall, if you were to go to basic training in the Army, you're looking at about 10 weeks, plus you have your military occupational specialty, which every soldier has to have a specialty, and that can range anywhere from 2 weeks to a few months, depending on what specialty you choose.
Now, what was your specialty in the Army?
Mine was what's called NBC. It's not the TV channel. It's actually Nuclear, Biological, and Chemical Operations Specialty.
Yeah, and
that was a 10-week school.
That was 10 weeks. It sounded like that's fairly heavy material that you've got to cover. So that was an additional 10 weeks on top of the 10 weeks of basic training. So, Mike, if people are listening to the sound of our voice and maybe they have been through boot camp at some point in their lives, what would surprise my listeners the most who went to boot camp, say, a couple decades ago about today's basic training?
You know, I think they would be surprised not just from the changes, but from what's still the same. You know, you arrive, you have your day one, which is your first day of basic training, which is the worst. There's still some, if you talk to anybody who's been to basic training, there's still some remarkable memories that come out of that. Every detail of that day, whoever's been to basic training can remember that. And they'll also remember how, you know, mean drill sergeants are, although nowadays they don't physically hit recruits. That's a big question I get from a lot of recruits. You know, can drill sergeants hit me? The answer is no, not like the old days, I guess, from the 60s and 70s, but at the same token, drill sergeants can still wear you down mentally, and they really don't need to hit you anymore. There's so many great mental exercises they can give you to just make you feel terrible if they wanted you to.
Wow. Well, that brings up a very interesting point that you cover in your book, Mike. That is, how do you deal with drill sergeants? I mean, the treatment sounds like it's changed a little bit, but, you know, how do you deal with them? What are some of the tips that you've got in your book that help you endure the, you know, the agony that you know they're going to put you through?
Well, the number one tip I had put in my book is know what they want to expect from you. Too many people go to boot camp expecting to make friends with their drill sergeants, to get on their good side. That's not what they want from you. Their job is to build you up into a soldier and break you down as a civilian in just a few weeks. The only way they can do that is to be mean. If you can just imagine it the other way around, you know, if drill sergeants wanted to be your friend, picture Richard Simmons, you know, as your exercise motivator. You wake up at 10 o'clock, you have a pancake breakfast, you go and work out with Richard Simmons in your little glittery shorts. You know, that's not going to build a very strong army, right?
Right.
So their job is to really get you to hate them and motivate you in that way. And the problem is many people don't get motivated when you're getting yelled at. But it really is the best way to motivate somebody quickly is just to get them to hate you and to get out of there as quick as possible, to learn what they're telling you. And that's the best thing to learn. And that's what I teach in my book, is to really understand what drill sergeants want from you. Know how to make friends with other recruits, because you can't make it through basic training without friends. So the book focuses many chapters on little tips and tricks on what you can do to, A, avoid getting yelled at by a drill sergeant, but, B, when you do get yelled at, understand why you're getting yelled at and what you can do to minimize this this mental pressure as much as possible.
All right. We're talking to Sergeant Mike Volkin. He is the author of the book, The Ultimate Basic Training Guidebook, Tips, Tricks, and Tactics for Surviving Boot Camp. And I guess, Mike, what would be some of those tips that you would give about dealing with the drill sergeant? What would be one or two things that you could give us?
Well, number one, I would say don't volunteer for anything. That's a big problem. When drill sergeants first meet you at basic training, they're going to look for that person who is the show-off, the one with the loudmouth, the one who wants to do the push-ups, the muscle head who thinks that he knows it all. And those are the guys that they are going to focus on throughout basic training to really break them down most. That's their strategy, is to find the people who need to get broken down the most. So you have to arrive at basic training with the mindset that you should do what you're told. It's surprising, but military, does, in the basic training at least, does not want to train leaders. They want to train people who can follow orders and directions well. They do not want a leader to emerge at basic training. So if you're the one raising your hand, volunteering, telling people what to do, then you are going to get picked on the most, and you're going to have a terrible time at basic training.
Now, that's advice. That's good advice right there, and contrary, counterintuitive almost to what people might think. So that is good. Well, Mike, looking back on your career, did you ever run across some of your old drill sergeants? And if you did, what was that reunion like?
I never had to. I saw one on Facebook, but I never emailed him. Drill sergeants are only drill sergeants for a couple years. You know, they're the best of the best soldiers. They're in there on the assignment. It's a 20-hour day for them, so they do it for a couple years, and then they're out doing another project. But at the very least, I did not luckily have to run in on any. However, on my way out, there was one particular drill sergeant that I really did not like. He had it in for me for some reason or another, probably because I went in with a master's degree, and he thought maybe that I was egotistical. But I was on my way out to the airport, and he stopped, and he said, Specialist Volkin, I was a specialist at the time, he said, I just want to let you know you did a great job. And I've never heard a compliment come out of that man's mouth. That's probably the only compliment he's ever said in his life, but he gave me a smile. I've never seen his teeth before, so it was my last impression of basic training, and it was a good one. And I, you know, that one sentence really stuck with me in my mind even to this day, many
yeah.
years later.
Very clearly, it sticks out in your memory. We're talking to Sergeant Mike Volkin. And Mike, you've done all this work on basic training as it is today. What changes do you foresee happening in basic training in the future?
Well, I see changes in the fitness regimen very clearly. In fact, I mentioned earlier the off-school course. They are changing. The fitness test now is sit-ups and push-ups in a two-minute period to see how many you can do. Mm-hmm. There's also a two-mile run. The higher-ups in the military have just announced an obstacle course-style PT, which is fitness test, and you would actually have to carry your rucksack and go across balance beams and the whole bit, run in your combat uniform, which is much more indicative to what you would see in a combat field, especially in urban combat. So that's another change that I see that's a most dramatic change, because even as far back as the 60s or 70s, you are having timed two-minute fitness tests. And even when I was doing them, I'm thinking, this really doesn't test my fitness. So what you're doing in a battlefield is clearly what you're going to be doing now in the next couple months for fitness tests.
And that makes sense. But you bring up a very interesting point about the changing nature of battle. I mean, in World War II, we were fighting in pretty much open fields and plains and in terrain that we're familiar with. Even in Vietnam, although it was jungle, it was still very much conventional fighting. Today, how is urban warfare different from the more traditional types of fighting that they had to teach to in the 60s and 70s?
Well, it's night and day difference. I mean, with urban warfare, you're not only training, but you're looking around corners, you're up close with your fellow platoon members. You know, in an open field, you're spread out. You've got your positions. You've got your foxholes you're in. With combat, urban combat, that is, you're have to do search and entry tactics where you're breaking down doors. Civilians are in the way. You don't know what's coming from a 360-degree angle. In an open field, your combat experience is more directed towards one direction. You can GPS the enemy's location. There's a lot of extra time you might have setting up shots, but in urban combat fighting, it's a lot of instinctual actions you have to take to be effective. So there's a lot more combative tactics you would have to learn in just a short period of time at basic training. So there's a lot of strategy. And one of the things I like to say is basic training is anything but basic now. It's a lot more detailed mentally and physically than it was 20, 30 years ago.
Yeah, it does sound very much more complex than it was 20, 30 years ago. We're talking to Sergeant Mike Volkin, author of the book, The Ultimate Basic Training Guidebook, Tips, Tricks, and Tactics for Surviving Boot Camp. And Mike, looking back on your career, what did you get out of your experience in the Army?
Well, other than being physically fit, which I still try to do today, you know, it's kind of inspired me to be maintain my physical fitness. But most important, what I got was my mental toughness, my confidence in approaching tasks, even in civilian life. It's translated well, even on paper, on resume. There's some specific things you can do and say on your resume that's really impressive, no matter what field you're going into. But I approach tasks now as a leader. And not so much a follower. I approach tasks with confidence that I can get things done, and if I can't, I know the resources on how to get it done. So it's not just helped me on the military side of things, but mentally on the civilian side as well.
That's good. Now, Mike, you've got an open microphone to people listening in Ventura and Santa Barbara, California. What do you want listeners to know about serving in today's military?
Well, for those of you who are on the fence, thinking about joining the military or who have always wanted to, now is an excellent time. With the economy the way it is, you can always count on the military to give you a steady job. It's going to be hard work. It's not a get-rich-quick scheme to join the military, but it's solid work. It'll help you both mentally and physically, and that's what I wanted to say. If anybody there is on the fence between joining the military or maybe is stuck in a job that they don't want to be, I would consider your military options. There's plenty of occupational specialties. There's an interest for everybody, no matter if you want to be a rifleman or a chemical operations specialist or a truck driver. There's something for everybody to do in the military, and everybody can use your help. If you want to join the military, now is an excellent time to do so.
Sound advice. We've been talking to Sergeant Mike Volkin, author of the book, The Ultimate Basic Training Guidebook, Tips, Tricks, and Tactics for Surviving Boot Camp. Mike, if people like what they hear, they want to learn more about you, where would you direct them to go on the internet?
Yeah, well, my website is ultimatebasictraining.com. I put a lot of tips on there, and that's ultimatebasictraining.com. In fact, I put a coupon code up there. If any of you guys want to buy the guidebook, it's $5 off if you use the promo code radio.
Oh, that is great. Mike, thank you so much for being our special guest. We'll talk to you down the road.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And just remember, a quick reminder, if you missed this or any of the interviews that I do, you can find them up on my website, brainstorminonline.com. That's brainstormin, STORMIN, online.com. You want to join us on